Well, good morning and welcome. We are delighted to have all of you here, and we're especially delighted to have President John Fry, the president of Drexel University, with us, and the past president of Franklin and Marshall College, and the former vice president and executive at the University of Pennsylvania. He's left a huge mark in the Pennsylvania area, and especially in Philadelphia. John, we're thrilled to have you here today.
Thanks, Art.
This morning's Sunday Faith Forum is offered in honor of the late Carl Buchholz, who was an active member of our congregation and a great leader in Philadelphia and in the region beyond. And he developed a profound friendship with you, John. And I thought we might just begin by talking a little bit about what Carl imparted to you and what he did on the Board of Trustees. I was amazed that in the last 2 weeks of Carl's life, especially the amount of time you took off to be able to visit with him in the hospital and then pay several visits at his home. And on the last day of Carl's life, you arrived and bestowed upon him an honorary doctorate and draped over his shoulders the doctor's hood. And that was one of the most touching things that ever happened in his life. And so can you share with us a little bit about Carl and your friendship together?
So Carl was appointed by Governor Corbett as a Commonwealth Trustee. We have five Commonwealth Trustees at the university, and many people have treated that kind of honorifically, and not Carl. Carl came to me right away and said, I'm excited about doing this, but I want some real assignments. So he took on audit. He took on something called complex transactions whenever we do big complicated mergers or real estate deals. And then he took on an assignment that regarding international travel, which was complicated and had a lot of legal aspects to it. And so he went sort of right to work. And you know, Carl was very good to me because he was one of the trustees who I can count on that in the midst of challenging times, I would always get a call saying, can I come down and spend some time with you? And kind of offline, he would walk me through his thoughts and ideas or strategies, and he had a very good sense of the rhythms of a university and its governance in particular. And that advice, which I took again and again over the years, was invaluable to me. And also, it was, I think, a deep expression of his friendship and support for me, because I think he knows that I have a complicated job, and he was there really to help, but to do it in a way that would equip me to do my best in the larger setting. So most of our conversations were before kind of moments of truth at our university. And you don't have many people doing that. You have a lot of critique afterwards. You have a lot of critics during. But Carl got me prepared for the road ahead. And it was a wonderful, wonderful thing to have him by my side.
Carl spoke to me many times about you as a leader. And he wanted us to have a chance to get together. I'm so glad we had a chance to have lunch about a month ago, and
That's great. Thank you
for that time. What, in your words, are the responsibilities of a leader? Every leader has a different take on what it means to lead. How would you share that with others, what it means for you to be a leader?
Well, there are a couple of dimensions. I think what leaders want to do is they want to enfranchise people in whatever the organization is or the cause is. And I think that means from the very beginning allowing people the opportunity to try and to fail, to take ownership, even though you may think there's a faster way of doing things, let people find their own pace, and really making sure that they understand how their work is directly related to something larger than themselves, be it the organization or the big thing that you're trying to do. And while that takes more time, I think, initially, what happens is that people take up things as their own. It becomes very personal. They become owners of whatever the entity or whatever the cause is. And I think what happens over time is the leader's role becomes less of directing people and more of sort of pushing them forward to do their best work, and then allowing them, of course, to get the accolades and the credit. I think too often what you see leaders do is really sort of kind of harvest the credit and the attention for themselves. And I think the best leaders are the ones who make sure that When times are tough, they're the ones who sort of take responsibility and ownership. And when things happen well, everyone is sort of put in front of them, because as a leader, you have the deep and quiet satisfaction of knowing what your role was, and you were given the privilege to lead. But you can watch with great pride as all these people are basically feeling wonderful about the work that they've done, contributing to whatever the success is, and knowing that they're protected from any criticism by the leader who's going to again run interference. The reason why all of that is important is that once something good is done, people want to do it again and again and again. And so you're priming the organization for a sense of mission and success and sort of destiny. And after a while, something starts to occur in the culture, I think over many years, where things that used to be really hard or intimidating or things that maybe people backed away from, they're now embracing because they have that sense of confidence. They have that sense of ownership. And then I think eventually they have their own sense of stewardship for the organization. And, you know, I think that to me is the art of this whole thing. It's difficult. You never quite get it right. But I think that the best organizations, the ones that make the most impact, are when the people who work there take it so deeply personal and really feel it's theirs.
So what do you look for? It seems to me one of the most important things that a leader can do is develop other leaders around them.
Yes.
And I was so impressed with your staff and how they interacted and their incredible follow-through. What do you look for in building up and, you know, engaging leaders around you?
You know, I first and foremost look for people who sort of get what the mission is and have a passion for it. I mean, if you feel so strongly about something that you'll, you know, run through brick walls, you know, to help get there, that to me is the most essential thing. And people bring all sorts of skill sets, and it's the leader's job to sort of assemble the right skill sets. But I think much less about that, and I think much more about the temperament of the person for the work of the organization, and do they really care? Are they you know, willing to sort of throw themselves into it? And then after that, it's a matter of assembling the right mix of skills and talents. But a mission-driven organization, you know, one that really sees itself going and doing great things for other people, I mean, if someone has that kind of heart, I want them on my team. And we'll figure out if they have a skills deficit here or there, we'll figure out how to help them with that. We'll work around that. But you can't buy heart.
Right. Well said. Now, you grew up in the Roman Catholic Church, I believe, right?
I did.
Can you tell us a little bit about what led you to the Episcopal Church? And you're a member of the Church of the Redeemer in Bryn Mawr, I believe.
Right.
But what you shared a little bit of your journey with me over lunch, and I thought it was wonderful.
So, like many Episcopalians, I grew up in the Roman Catholic Church, and when I met my wife, Kara, she didn't really have a faith tradition. And so I went about the work of seeing how we could sort of put something together that would make sense. And we lived in New York at the time, and we found a wonderful church called St. John's Church in Cold Spring Harbor. And I thought that the setting there, and I stumbled into it one Sunday morning. I was, I guess, shopping by myself, and I stumbled into it, and there was the rector had been there for 32 years, and it was a small church. It was built in the early 1800s, and Lewis Comfort Tiffany had lived up the hill from this church, and he designed the stained glass windows. And so you walk into this very simple 1835 structure with these three sublime Tiffany, you know, windows, which are all just magnificent and done by Tiffany himself. And the setting was stunning, and the music was beautiful. And I thought to myself, this is a deeply spiritual place that I thought would appeal to Kara. And so the next week I brought her, and it did. And, you know, we've had very happy experiences at St. John's, at the Redeemer, now twice around, and in between at St. James Church in Lancaster. And so, you know, the church has become deeply important to me, I think important to my wife as well, and to the children. But for me, it's essential. I don't think I could do most of what I try to do without knowing that Peter van der Veen is our rector. I had coffee with him, you know, yesterday morning. And, you know, without that kind of, you know, pastoral guidance, it sometimes you can lose your perspective. I have had friends to help me at the Redeemer not lose my perspective.
So how does your faith impact your daily life and how you lead within the university context? And also with the Chamber of Commerce, and you lead in so many different dimensions.
Well, I think it's an ever-present reminder that, you know, the work that we're doing, you know, should never be viewed as sort of transactional and trying to just to get ahead. But, you know, the responsibility, I think, of any great organization, and particularly of a great university, is to provide, you know, access to all the riches that the institution has to offer, and not just to the people who attend or work there, but to the communities that surround it. And you know, most of you know that West Philadelphia over the years has been it's a pretty tough place. There are parts of West Philadelphia, Mantua in particular, which is the neighborhood immediately to our north, that has the third highest poverty rate in the city. It has endemic unemployment. It has very low educational attainment, and it has many generations of poverty. And so, you know, as a leader of my university, I don't want my institution to be sort of hermetically sealed and not aware of the pain and the suffering and the despair of this neighboring community. So I think that what we've tried to do at Drexel, and what I've tried to do in other places that I've been privileged to work, is to make sure that there's no ivory tower, that the institution engages deeply with its neighbors in a mutually beneficial relationship. It's not the experts coming to tell the neighbors what to do to make their lots better, but in fact, deep listening and understanding of what the situation is, and then a commitment to sort of working together over a period of time. And I feel now, although that work will stretch many decades ahead, because most things that are good take many decades to get to, that we're on a trajectory now of not only being a better university from a teaching and a research perspective, but also from a service perspective. I mean, universities are founded on three pillars: teaching, research, and service. Typically, service is kind of in third place, not a lot of attention and thought really given to what service means. And as a result of the work that we've been doing in our communities, which is hard and difficult and really compelling work, I feel like that third leg of our mission has become much more robust. And, you know, as a result, I think we've become a much more humane place. I think people understand, you know, the situation that we have and all the benefits that we have and why we need to share those benefits. And it's, I think some of that is rooted in my experience in the church, and some of it is because I think that my students will be better educated and have a better experience if they understand the full breadth of the human condition.
Mm-hmm. Now, you lead one of the nation's major universities. You've just begun a two-year term as president of the Philadelphia Chamber of Commerce. You're on a three-year term with the American Council of Education, the nation's most influential higher education association. What keeps you up late at night?
Honestly, the welfare and safety of my students. You know, we have a generation of students who are attending college now that, you know, many have, you know, suffered from all sorts of difficult situations. Many arrive with mental health problems. I worry that students tend to stay out late at night on the weekends, come home, and aren't really sort of aware of their surroundings. And so what worries me, and as someone who has lost students and had to spend time with parents and families afterwards, it's the single worst thing when someone is hurt or lost. And so what I worry about every day and every night is, are these kids going to be okay? Can we, if they're in pain, can we figure out a way of finding out in advance so we can help them? And if they get into trouble, you know, what can we do for themselves and for them and their families? And honestly, Mark, everything else, like, sounds hard and difficult to do, but compared to that, it's easy. Mm-hmm. I just want everyone to be well cared for and feeling good about themselves. And if that happens, the rest of the work gets sort of put into that context, and it's fine. It's challenging, but it's fine.
Now, you're celebrating your 125th year as an institution. You put together this beautiful book, which is sensational. And Anthony Joseph Drexel was a visionary philanthropist and futurist. How is his vision formed the university in such a way that his legacy just continues on? What's the DNA of it that made it so special?
I gave a public lecture about this on Tuesday. We have every week we have chapter authors come and give a public talk, and so mine was on, you know, why Drexel's life remains relevant today to this institution, because in many cases founders are not, you know, they're recalled in a historical context. Drexel was extraordinary. He was a very, very wealthy financier, and I think he saw with the Industrial Revolution that a new generation of students, men and women, black and white, and all other, you know, sort of traditions, needed to be educated. And so he took the very radical step in 1889 of founding the Drexel Institute for Art, Science, and Industry, and made it accessible to working class men and women throughout Philadelphia. He located the university in a very particular place. It was the hub of a lot of transportation access so that people could commute. He did a lot with industrial arts so that people would have real skills to get jobs. And then as part of his founding gift, he gave $1 million to the first president to go to Paris to buy art for the Institute on the theory that while these kids were there and studying, in between classes, they could look at art and develop an aesthetic appreciation. And, you know, so the things that he did at our founding, and then, of course, this all led to cooperative education, you know, a few years later. Our location, the way we do education, the access that we provide all people, regardless of their circumstances, are the tenets of Drexel in 2016. And through his writings and things that he left behind, I see the hand of someone still working, you know, 125 years later. It is almost eerie at times. I'll pick up things and read them that he said, and I'll think, this is as powerful and germane today as it was, you know, back then. And back then, you know, higher education wasn't accessible and not affordable for most. And, you know, women were not given the opportunity to go to school, except in a few, you know, cases where there were women's colleges. And to think that from the very beginning he was thinking in such contemporary terms that are so relevant even today, you know, I feel like we have a very special person who founded the institution. And like we talked about before about leadership, he didn't even go to the dedication of the Institute because he felt too much attention and praise would be heaped upon him. And so he decided at the last second not to go. Unfortunately, he didn't really see the fruits of his labors. He died about 2 years later in 1893. But what a soulful thing that he did for our institution.
So you've kind of summarized a little bit about where Drexel's come. Where do you see it going from here? What's the vision look like for the future?
And, you know, maybe I can frame this in larger terms, too, because people in this room have gone to all sorts of wonderful colleges and universities. I think we're at a time of real crisis in American higher education. You know, maybe there are a few institutions that have the cushion of a great endowment and a very competitive applicant pool, but most institutions don't have any significant endowment. They don't have the advantage of you know, 10, 20, 30 applications per slot. And I think there's going to be a sort of a sea change in the sector. And at the same time, public universities are being dramatically underfunded. And so this is a sector that is about to go into kind of a healthcare-like state, say 20 years ago. I think that's going to happen to higher education today. So I frame that because I think that these institutions are going to have to be much more innovative, much more activist, much more applied in the best sense of that word in terms of their thinking. And I think the idea of, you know, all we do is teach the theory and we leave the practice to what happens when you graduate, I don't think that model is going to work anymore. And I think as an institution that has embraced both theory and practice, sliding back and forth on that continuum, I think that kind of education, especially then if done not only in person but in a hybrid way and online, so that all modalities are easy to, you know, get access to. And then I also think, and people may think this is you know, a little bit radical, but I don't think that the agrarian calendar, which we exist on, is going to exist in the future. I mean, I organizing ourselves by an agrarian calendar to teach young students today is completely ridiculous. Many of them are in school maybe 7.5 months a year. So what happened, you know, what happened to the other 4.5 months? And so my experience is that students want more. They want more. They want more community. They want more activity. They want more engagement. And they don't like 4.5 months of not being at their institution. So you can do a 4-year degree, I think, in 3 years easily. even with some study abroad, which is always a good thing to knit in. If you look at the calendar, not as an artifact, but as something that, you know, people's time is valuable. So I think for Drexel, certainly, and we're working on all the things I just mentioned, but for other institutions as well, there's going to be a lot of change going forward, and the institutions that hold on to the past, especially the ones without the resources to, you know, afford them to do that, are going to get washed out. And I think you're going to see a lot of consolidation in the sector.
Tell us some of the benefits of the co-op model, and do you think we're going to see more universities go in that direction where you can apply that teaching and learn on site, so to speak?
Yeah. So I think co-op historically has had a bad rap, and it's, well, this is a kind of applied education. It's really only about getting a job, and that's really not the case. So for those of you who don't know how cooperative education works, a typical Drexel undergraduate comes for either 5 years or 4 years. If they come for the five-year program three times during those 5 years, they leave for 6 months for a job that we help secure for them based on them interviewing for the job. The jobs are all compensated. The average compensation is $16,000. And these are real jobs. These are not internships where people are running to get coffee or making copies, because no one's going to pay someone $16,000 average to do that. So they go out at age 19, which is, you know, a young age, and all of a sudden they find themselves working at IBM for 6 months. And there's a whole bunch of things going on. First of all, you have a job and you have to show up and you have to understand the etiquette of work. You also have to understand the politics of, you know, work environments. And all that stuff can't really be taught in a classroom. You just got to figure that out. You got to absorb it, and you have to have enough of, you know, confidence and sense of yourself to deal with that. Yes, you're learning all sorts of things, and that's really important. And you're making a network. Last year when we graduated, the class at Drexel, 50% of the people who walked across the stage had at least one job offer from one of their co-op employers. And so, for co-op employers, a lot of the risk is taken out of hiring. If you have a student for 6 months, you know whether or not they're going to be able to do the job. But that's not the important thing about co-op. I mean, the resume building and the skills development is great. But the important thing, in my mind, is that if you're in a workplace for 6 months and then you come back into the classroom, you're a different kid. You're going to ask different questions. You're going to have different insights. If someone is reading off their yellow notes to you and saying this or that, you should raise your hand and say, you know, Professor X, I understand that, but how come at IBM the situation was so dramatically different? So our students, I think, become more discerning and they're more mature. And so by the time you go through three of those cycles and you're 23 years old, you're a completely different young adult. And having had the privilege of working at Penn and F&M, honestly, the Drexel seniors are far more, you know, sophisticated and mature about the way of the world because they've had this intense immersion into all these workplaces. And, you know, we would hope that in addition to maybe, you know, one or two domestic co-ops, they would also do a co-op abroad in the language of the native country. So these are very complicated and rich experiences, but what they do is they make the classroom part, I think, much more relevant and impactful because they're more fully engaged. They're not just passively listening to the theory. They're challenging the theory based on their own experience.
Online education, threat or opportunity?
Huge opportunity. I think students right now, even, I don't think they discern much of a difference because it depends on the subject matter. It depends on their schedules. I think they want to consume in-person education, online education, and hybrid education, and they're going to go back and forth pretty seamlessly among those three. I think it's the institutions that are making a big deal about this because it's different. You know, back to my point about, you know, higher ed as an industry that's about to undergo transformation, you know, online education done correctly can be extremely powerful. I mean, as a product of a liberal arts environment and as a president of a liberal arts college before Drexel, I loved the seminar room with 10 kids in it. I mean, you know, everyone loves the Harkness table and the interaction that facilitates. But in the end, we also have the need to consume information and get education at all points of our life, and online makes that possible. I have so many people I have 5,000 students who are getting their degrees online at Drexel, mostly at the graduate level. Their advancement in what they're doing and what they're passionate about is in many cases dependent on that degree. They are not going to quit their jobs and come back to school, you know, for 2 years straight. They have families, they have obligations. Online makes it possible for them to get that kind of advancement. So I think that we're going to see it continue to go like this.
Education is going global. Can you tell us a little bit about Drexel's global partnerships?
Yeah, you know, I think, first of all, you know, co-op abroad, study abroad is just a foundational, you know, thing for any institution, and especially for young men and women today. Everyone should go abroad and spend some time. For Drexel, you know, many institutions have set up branch campuses in different countries. Honestly, I think that's a little bit pretentious. I'm not sure, you know, what we would be able to gain and give if we set up a branch campus somewhere else. What we do is something different. We have the benefit of many faculty who have worked and trained with colleagues from across the world in many different universities. And so we have started over the last 5 years to form partnerships with those universities, maybe one or two in a specific number of countries, where we kind of embed ourselves there from a locational standpoint and do joint degree programs, joint PhDs, joint masters, and kind of team up with the host university to offer these kind of programs. So right now we're in China, India, South Korea, Chile, Brazil, and Israel, and we were in Turkey, and we're taking a break because the situation is pretty chaotic over there. We'll probably just stick to those institutions. And within each of those countries, we have 2 to 3 universities that we have these very deep teaching and research partnerships with, so that when I go to Shanghai now, I can go to a Drexel branch of Shanghai Tech embedded within the institution, and I'll see my Drexel students here. We'll welcome Shanghai Tech students to Philadelphia. And it creates these sort of ecosystems of exchange, I'm hoping that over time, as we do our own continued development, we'll be hosting many more of those students here as well. So there is a fair exchange back and forth. But that's how we're doing our international work, and it's actually become quite a profound part of what we're doing. We're going to Africa. This will be my second trip. We work with a non-governmental organization called World Vision, which brings fresh water and best sanitation practices to remote African villages. I have 20 masters of public health students in 5 different countries in Africa right now doing that kind of work. And so there's a service component built in. So I think we'll do much more in Africa in the future in partnership with these kind of organizations.
Now, the universities are impacted by what takes place in Washington. What are your thoughts or concerns about a Trump presidency and how that would impact Drexel and other higher education institutions?
I'm worried about some of the messaging in terms of how it impacts our international student recruitment. And so I think that's something to watch out for. I think that there's some promise in terms of his early remarks about wanting to invest in infrastructure, because I think, you know, education is infrastructure. But also transportation and some of the things that we're doing in Philadelphia, I think could benefit from federal appropriations and interest in infrastructure like high-speed rail, which I think makes the Drexel campus a more accessible and therefore competitive place. So I think there are some things that could end up being positive. I think there are some things right now that look very negative. And I think that, look, the only thing we could do is not lament this, but to sort of charge into it and figure out, okay, what does it mean for us, and how can we sort of, you know, derive some goodness and some benefit from this?
Mm-hmm. Now, education seems to be in the bubble right now. Of the costs have been skyrocketing for college tuition. Students are graduating with tens of thousands of dollars of debt. What do you think is going to happen 10 years out?
I think you're going to see a sector squeeze. I think you're going to see many institutions closing because they simply cannot deliver the value for the cost that they demand. And I think we're seeing this already, particularly in private higher education. And I think that the smart institutions, and I'd like to consider Drexel one of them, is going to be on a big, you know, wave of experimentation. You know, 3-year undergraduate, you know, bachelor's degrees, you know, co-op, pressing our advantage because the average Drexel student earn about $50,000 from their co-ops, which helps underwrite some of the education. I think we'll see more of that online as part of the you know, set of offerings that students are allowed to take. I think things that make the value very rich. So when people decide to make the investment, they see the return on the investment as significant. Right now, many people are looking at some of the institutions and saying, I don't know why I would pay you this amount, because I'm not getting this in return. Many of them are fleeing to public universities, but the problem with public universities in many cases is that they're not being funded to accept all these students. And so, you know, if you try to get to, you know, the main campus of a flagship university like, say, Penn State, it's very, very difficult now because of the explosion in applications. And so many students end up going to some of their branch campuses, which is, I think, a different kind of experience. And so the public sector is under a lot of pressure. It's not just the private sector. But I think it's all going to be value for price. And if you can't demonstrate your value proposition, it's going to be hard for you to make it. And I'm talking over the next, I think, 10, 15, 20 years, I think we're going to see some real changes.
Mm-hmm. One of your first steps was to create an affiliation with the Academy of Natural Sciences. And I guess that began about 6 years ago, and it's been underway for about 5 years.
Yeah.
What did you see in that potential partnership, and are you happy with how it's developed so far? Yeah.
So we merged with the Academy of Natural Sciences in 2011, and I think from their perspective, they were an asset-rich, storied institution, great science, great collections, no liquidity, and a gate that had shrunk and shrunk and shrunk. And so they were sort of on the ropes financially. I think they probably could have continued on, but George Gephardt, who is the president of the Academy, I think thought that something more dramatic had to happen. And George and I are old friends. He was an F&M parent. We got together, we had coffee one day, and he's telling me all this, and I'm thinking, geez, we could be an interesting platform to support him. And selfishly thinking to myself, our institution is sort of nowhere in environmental policy and environmental science, and if we did a merger with them, we can create a lot of programs in those areas, I think become a better version of our university, and also these are new markets that we can attract, you know, students to. And so from that conversation, 9 months later we merged, 5 years later it has been a spectacular success. We're doing a huge amount of work, in particular in the Delaware watershed. William Penn has given us a significant amount of grants to do that work. We now have Academy scientists and Drexel scientists working together on those types of projects. You know, I think that's a model that we'll see other not-for-profits and universities follow, because I think in many cases you have universities that need to fill in whatever academic gaps that they have, and you have, you know, other institutions, be they universities, colleges, or not-for-profits, that can provide you know, expertise in those gaps, but don't have necessarily the wherewithal to continue on as independent institutions themselves. And so I think you're going to see a lot of these unusual combinations, and we've gotten a lot of feedback, positive feedback, on the fact that we've done this, maintaining the Academy's board and management team and brand and location and sense of itself, but at the same time it's attached to a large and capable university, and they haven't lost their identity, but they've given themselves now, you know, an entirely new lease on life.
Mm-hmm. Now, you want Drexel University to be the most civic-minded university in the country. And you have a history of working to improve neighborhoods adjacent to the university. You did that in beautiful ways at Penn. You've done that at F&M. It takes many forms of employment opportunities, investments, working with the local elementary schools. Can you tell us a little more about your vision of how Drexel can and is doing that?
Sure. So it in part goes back to the question you asked about, the kind of, you know, moral responsibility of these entities. And I think first and foremost, it is our responsibility to engage with those who have less than us as a sort of fundamental principle. What we did at Penn and at F&M, and now we're doing at Drexel, is we focused on basically a half a dozen areas, improving public safety, creating opportunities for affordable housing, helping to, in some cases, even build and operate excellent neighborhood public schools, improve commercial corridors with cultural offerings, with retail offerings, which creates also safe streets. The fifth is providing, affordable health care through a series of nurse-managed or physician-managed clinics. And then the last thing is employment opportunities, both at Drexel and within the context of some of the development that we're doing, you know, in and around University City. So if you take those six things, you know, public safety, housing, education, commercial corridors, healthcare, and jobs, and you provide supports and encouragement for your neighbors to take advantage of those things over time, and you do it in the context of not a 5-year strategic plan, but a decades and many decades long commitment, over time, you see the effects. And, you know, for those of you who know the University of Pennsylvania and where it was when Judy Roden became president in 1994, and see those surrounding neighborhoods right now, you see a dramatic change as a result of this kind of strategy. So we're trying to affect, in our own particular Drexel way, that for the Mantua and West Palatine neighborhoods as well. And it worked very well in its own particular version in Lancaster, you know, which is a city within a large rural county. But the city of Lancaster is about 50,000 people, and basically Franklin and Marshall served as the anchor institution for that city in many of these ways as well. It's pretty simple. It's not glamorous. It takes a long time. There's a lot of distrust from neighbors initially, because they view the institutions as having encroached on their neighborhoods and not necessarily increased the quality of life. And you need to spend a lot of time rebuilding that trust. But once these sort of investments start, you know, bearing fruit, I think it increases the desire for more collaboration. And back to your very first question, this creates the context for leadership as having a mission or a movement for people to gravitate towards. And so many people at these institutions are involved in now neighborhood work, whereas before, I don't think that we're even cognizant of what the issues were.
Mm-hmm. Now, people marvel at your ongoing building projects, and the Schuylkill Yards project is a very ambitious project. Can you tell us a little bit about how that will change Philadelphia?
Well, you know, we think one of Philadelphia's great competitive advantages is being on the Northeast Corridor, you know, basically halfway between, you know, Washington and New York, sort of on the 50-yard line of the Eastern Seaboard. And we think 30th Street Station, in particular, that location, will become the center of the city. You know, right now we think of the center of the city as Rittenhouse Square. The center of the city is moving to the river. The river is going to become the center of the city, and 30th Street Station is the kind of anchor of the river. And so what we've decided to do is to take advantage of some real estate purchases that we've made over time to basically purchase all the land around 30th Street Station, partner with Brandywine Realty Trust, which is a major developer, and make a commitment over the next 20 years to build about 8 million feet. It'll be about $3.5 billion worth of investment. And we will basically put our ground into these deals, and the investors will make the improvements, build the buildings. And so we have three projects that are starting right now. One is a 1.3-acre park, public park, which we call Drexel Square, immediately across 30th Street Station. So when you walk out the western door heading towards Drexel and Penn, there's a big parking lot there. That parking lot will become a public park. The Bulletin Building, which we own, will become a sort of life sciences incubator space. And then on the corner of 30th and JFK, there'll be a 700,000-square-foot tower that should break ground within the next year. Consider that the down payment on Schuylkill Yards. But the essence of Schuylkill Yards is to provide public spaces, innovation spaces, and spaces for, you know, research and education and corporate activity that over time come together into an ecosystem that resembles what's happening up in Cambridge, Massachusetts. If you see the extraordinary development around MIT, it's a place called Kendall Square. It's because MIT and Harvard, the space between them, has become connected by, you know, innovative businesses, incubators, you know, residences, retail, and it's become its own sort of vibrant innovation district. That's our sort of mind model for what we want to do around 30th Street Station. Mm-hmm. And, you know, by the time we get to the first quarter of 2019, I think we'll see the down payment on that.
So you have a very interesting model where you front the ground, developers come in and front the money, you build retail and dorm space housing into it, so they get an immediate return on their investment. Everyone seems to be happy. Where did you get that model from, and are other universities following suit and doing things like,
you know,
that?
We weren't the first, but I think, again, this is sort of, it's interesting because it's rooted in these sort of missional questions. And so for years and years, as Drexel grew from, you know, 7,000 or 8,000 students to 25,000 students, it never really built adequate residences on its campus. So where do the students go? They move into the neighborhoods. Are students good neighbors? No, they're awful neighbors. They stay out too late. They party. They don't pick up their trash. They got couches on the porches. It's all the bad stuff. And so what do single family home occupiers do? They get up and they leave. And what do real estate speculators do? They buy those houses, turn them into more apartments. So in Palatine Village, which is the neighborhood immediately next to Drexel, it's 16% owner-occupied. That used to be 100% owner-occupied. We, in effect, by not building residences, destroyed that neighborhood and turned it into a sort of adjacent student neighborhood, and it's run down, and it's a shame. So the first things we did were to go to the markets to find the capital. We built 3,000 new beds on our campus since 2011, simply because I want to get those 3,000 students out of those neighborhoods back onto my campus. I made a sophomore housing requirement. No one was happy about that. But then again, they all eventually graduate, and no one knows the difference anyway. And so it started to work out because we're allowing opportunities, along with the investments I told you about before, to let the neighborhood going back to be in a neighborhood and to make the campus a place where we can host all of our activities. And so the impetus came not because we decided we wanted to be, you know, real estate speculators one day, but because we looked and we said, look, we have a huge problem here, and we don't have the capital at our university to make those investments. So we went out to the market with some very attractive pieces of ground, and you know, we've had almost $400 million of private capital flow into the university since then. And we'll continue to do that based on the sort of need.
I get the sense that we are producing a more fragile student today. Students who insist on having trigger warnings before certain topics could be mentioned in the class. Students recently reported saying they could not walk across the campus and study there if an American flag were flying. Where they hiss collectively when certain topics come up or people speak or demand that invited speakers to campus back down. Are we producing young adults who have grit and resilience? How do you see that from Drexel's perspective and other universities?
I think we are. We, you know, these issues that you just raised are present at many campuses across the country, and I really feel terribly for, you know, my counterparts, because I think that what's going on is just a sort of, you know, infantile sort of view of what the world is like, that we have to protect ourselves from those things. And I think the reason why this has not occurred at our university is because, back to our co-op philosophy, you're 19 years old, you're out working, and it exposes you to the world, and you realize that, you know, maybe some of the things that you might think theoretically are good to avoid and not let people speak and whatever, that, you know, it's a free society out there, and you have to cope, you know, with all the difficulties and the challenges of a work environment and sort of figuring out how that impacts you in school. And our kids are not babied. In fact, it's tough. It's hard. It's hard being on a quarter system. It's hard going to co-op. It's hard trying to make everything sort of fit together. And we think that that experience over time develops real grit. And I think that in many cases, institutions are babying these students and playing to their sort of, you know, worst fears and assumptions. And, you know, I for one feel like, you know, our job is to set up a real world context, let these kids have a great arts and sciences education, work, live in a city, and understand, you know, all the joys and complexities of life. And if we don't do that, then they have a difficult time coming once they graduate, and then eventually have to confront that world anyway. Right. I'd rather them confront it when they're 18 than when they're 22.
Now, you were one of the few college presidents leading a major institution without a doctorate. In what ways is that an advantage, and are there some disadvantages?
Well, I mean, it's a disadvantage because it's actually hard to find a presidency without a doctorate. And so I've gotten to many final interviews where I think they finally figured out that I might have been a good interviewer, but they'll never hire me because I don't have a PhD. So there's a bit of discrimination there, let me put it that way. And that is what it is, because many places are very traditional and they want the president to be an accomplished, you know, teacher and scholar, which is fine. There's nothing wrong with that. So that's the disadvantage. I think the advantage is that I don't necessarily look at the world through the glasses of a traditional, you know, person who has spent all their time in academia. And I think that it's actually helped my institution, because I think what the context that I've been able to set up, particularly with my faculties, is that, you know, we respect each other's traditions, and those traditions are deeply important to each other. I really respect the nature of shared governance among faculty and among trustees. It's something that you don't see in corporate world where I used to be, but I see the power of that and the durability of that in terms of running an institution. They, I think, appreciate the fact that I bring a perspective where, you know, change is important. Change should be made quickly, surely, but quickly. and that sometimes a lot of time gets wasted for no reason at all, then this is the way we've done things. And so I push them very, very hard, but within the context of shared governance where we're constantly talking to one another, and I think they're absorbing my ideas, I'm absorbing their ideas, and I think we've come to sort of a happy, you know, happy medium, mm-hmm. and I think we're both better for it.
You've been extremely successful at Penn, at F&M, and now at Drexel in raising funds. Can you tell us something about the art of helping people to transition their resources to where their values are and how you go about that?
I think that's all about shared conversation and vision. The largest gifts that we've raised, and these have been in excess of $40-50 million, barely had a sort of moment of drama at all. There was never a sort of document given and a signature requested. It was more long, sustained conversations about issues that were in common and what together the donor and the institution could do about those issues. We do a lot civically, as you mentioned before. One of the individuals, Phil Lindy, now passed away, who helped us get going, was deeply passionate about these issues. He was a Penn graduate, actually. Found us, or we found him. And once we found each other, these conversations started to occur. And then the next thing you know, Phil gave $30 million to us in a series of gifts. And I don't recall ever asking him specifically for a gift. We're working on this project. He'd say, how can I help? I said, well, it's going to cost this much. And I'll help you do this. It was always directed by him based on the shared conversation. And I can tell you any other significant gift that I've raised, has been like that. And so I think it's donor and, asker, having the kind of deep mutual respect and friendship to engage in conversations. And in the end, the gift comes out. I mean, eventually everyone realizes what we need to do. And then it's a matter of, okay, how much can you do? How can I, make sure that this is done in an advantage way to you in terms of your circumstances? I too often it's considered a big dramatic thing. And I think if there's a lot of drama in the ask, that means the ask is not prepared yet.
How about Philadelphia? You've just accepted a 2-year term as president of the Chamber of Commerce. You're extremely busy. You have so many demands. What led you to say yes to this, and what is your vision for what you can accomplish in those 2 years? What would you love to see happen?
Well, I mean, maybe this is Catholic guilt, but the person who asked me was just as busy as me. And so when he showed up and asked if I could do it, I wasn't going to be able to use the too busy, excuse. It was someone I deeply respected who had, running a very, very busy company, had taken on this a number of years ago. And when he asked, there was only one answer because of the sacrifices that he made, the example that's given me, and the sacrifices I'll make in turn. And so that was just a simple matter of doing what people do when they're asked to do something. You just do it, and you figure out the time issue, later on. I think Philadelphia is at an extraordinary juncture right now in terms of opportunities to really build itself into a world-class city, one of the most competitive metropolitan regions in the country. I think we have the assets to get there. If you take a look at our Eds and Meds and anchor institutions like Comcast and, the vibrant, civic life that we have in terms of arts and culture and restaurants and the fastest growing millennial population in the United States, I mean, all these treasures. But what we need to do is create an ecosystem to get more cooperation and collaboration among those big anchor institutions and among all the other assets. And I think it'll be there for us to proclaim one day that we are one of the world's great 25 cities. At the same time, 26% of our citizens live in poverty, number one in the country among major cities. That's an outright disgrace. We have more resources to be able to help people with those kind of difficulties, and I don't think we've turned our full attention onto it. And so I think the agenda of the chamber is to focus on building that top, worldwide 25 metro, and at the same time taking that 26% rate and thinking about how we begin to drive that down over time, and the people who are now in poverty become included in the opportunities for prosperity going forward. A really easy thing to say, a really difficult thing to do, but if you're not thinking about innovation and inclusivity in the same way, then you're going to have a balance that's not going to work either way.
Mm-hmm. In your address to the Chamber of Commerce at their annual meeting, you quoted Manuel Castells, who once opined, cities like ours could become globally connected and locally disconnected. Is that part of what you're looking at? How do we, in a way, take care of everyone here, that everyone rises, rather than select premier institutions within the city?
I'm very fearful of this, and even the conversation around millennials. And so, you know, millennials, our mind's eye view of millennials are a bunch of kids living in Center City and University City with great jobs and who all went to wonderful institutions and have all sorts of, you know, prospects and possibilities, you know, for the future. I have a bunch of millennials living in Mantua, too, that barely graduated from high school, if they did, no college education, living in, again, generational poverty. They're millennials, too. So it's like the tale of the two millennial populations. But we know a lot of those millennials in Mantua, you know, want a job, want to make a better life for themselves, you want to have families. And if we're spending all of our time sort of, congratulating ourselves for, you know, the vast influx of millennials into the city of Philadelphia who are prosperous and not worrying about the ones who are struggling, you know, again, that we may look good globally, but we'll be completely disconnected locally. And I think that's sort of the way we're all thinking about this now, is that we have too many people who are disenfranchised from all the good things that are happening in Philadelphia right now, and we should not rest until we can really begin to mitigate those circumstances.
Now, the Chamber has partnered with the Brookings Institute to do a study of the city. What did the Brookings Institute reveal about the city of brotherly love?
Well, it basically confirmed what I just said. It said the potential to be a top 25 global city is within your reach from an asset standpoint. It is a poorly constructed ecosystem. There is an astounding lack of collaboration among the major institutions, and there is much unnecessary duplication among a lot of the intermediary not-for-profit institutions. So everyone likes to start a not-for-profit anytime there's a question or a problem, as opposed to looking at what exists and sort of getting those institutions to be, you know, involved. I think that was number one. So they basically kind of put it back to us and said, if you really want to be a top 25, you know, global city, you have the assets, but you don't have the temperament and you don't have the ecosystem. It's a hard thing to listen to, but I think it's true.
So that's the biggest thing holding us back?
That and the fact that this sort of crushing level of poverty and so many disenfranchised people throughout, you know, the city, and, you know, the question comes back, how do you call yourself great and competitive if all this stuff is going on within sight? I mean, it's really interesting to spend time in Mantua, and we have an extension center there, so we spend a lot of time working with our neighbors. Many of them don't go or feel invited to go into Center City. If you stand at any point of Mantua and you look east, you can see the whole city of Philadelphia. It's right there, like Oz. But they don't feel invited to go to Oz. Like when we merged with the academy, you know, one of the things we discovered is that a lot of the kids who were in these neighborhoods, they didn't feel like they were allowed to go. They were allowed to go to the academy. So somehow we have created in people's minds that these are two separate places, and you better keep them apart. And I think we got to think about how to bring them together, because when you bring them together, amazing things happen for all parties involved.
We found that even here at St. Thomas Church. We have leaders who've been so great at getting us involved in a myriad of outreach endeavors. We operate a summer camp for inner city children to come out here. When the yellow school buses park on the campus, right on the fields, some of the children are hesitant to get out because they've never set foot on grass like that in a big field, and the whole thing seems very strange to them.
Right.
How can you see churches like ours participating in the equation? What would Redeemer and St. Thomas have a lot in common? What do you think Episcopal churches and other mainline churches need to be doing to make our region and our city a better place?
You know, I think that, and you've just illustrated with the summer camp program, I think that there is a sense that places that exist on hills or in ivory towers are not for the people who are not there, and the people who are there don't necessarily need to wander off of that because life is pretty good up here, right? So why would I spend a whole lot of time worrying about what's happened on Germantown Avenue? Because, you know, what's calling me there? I think the church facilitates those connections so good people can get involved. I think leadership from the church to say, you know, what's really important to us is not our own community, which is, of course, at the core, but all the things that our communities could do to spread God's word, frankly, in real and meaningful and tangible ways to people who don't have the benefits that we have. And I think the rest of it is a bunch of programs and tactics. I think it's the attitude that we're an activist anchor institution. Our job is not merely to convene among ourselves and talk among ourselves. That's just the way we start. But the way we finish is that we spread out and we push out. And in many cases, it's not an easy thing to figure out, well, where do I want to volunteer and how do I want to support? The church should have the resources to facilitate and point people in those kind of directions and say, you know, we're really going to, you know, be devoted to this particular neighborhood. It's adjacent to us. It's had years of hard times. We're going to dig in and make friendships and build relationships and build a network between our church and that particular neighborhood, just to pick on that. And I think the church needs to lead on that. I think universities need to lead on that, because people left to their own devices may be upset about this and concerned, but they don't necessarily know what to do about it. We can help them figure out what to do something about it.
You have so many demands on your time. I was amazed you go to attend volleyball games for your students, and you made time for us to have lunch for an hour, and you're out here with us today. How do you prioritize, in ways that we might learn, everyone here is very busy, where to invest time and energy? How do you make those decisions?
Well, I think that the way you start, schedules are schedules. But you have to have a very elastic view of your day, because there's always someone who needs you for something. And if you can't figure out how to make time possible for those people, then you're not doing your job. And so you may have 14 meetings, but there may be three other people out there who need to see you. You need to figure out how to get to those people. You need to push yourself, you know, in terms of your hours. You need to do things more quickly. But you need to know where they are, and you need to know how to get to them. And so there'll be many days where I'll look at my schedule and say, this is absolutely going to be a nightmare today. And yet at the end of the day, I did four more things than that. Because not everything goes in a schedule. You can't sort of plan everything. Stuff happens. And you have to figure out how to make yourself super elastic to sort of absorb that. And that means sometimes, you know, you call audibles during the day, you move things, you change things, because you need to get to the problem. And sometimes the problem is, you know, it just happens. As you know, you deal with a lot of this yourself. And so I don't get too hung up on, yeah, I got a busy schedule. Everyone's got a busy schedule. And so I just try to figure out how I can get a little more out of every day.
What's the hardest decision for you to have to make?
When you need to make changes in your leadership team. And most people, you know, they're good people. They want to do the right thing. But there's a certain point in time when if you don't see that kind of leadership that the institution needs and deserves, and you've given them plenty of opportunities to try, then what you have to do is you have to have the conversation. You can't delegate that. You need to do it yourself. And then you need to do two things. You need to celebrate that person's time at the institution, and then you need to find them the next job. You need to be a reference. You need to be relentlessly writing letters, making networks for them, because when they get settled in their next thing, there's a sort of what goes around comes around thing. If people are summarily fired, no one thanks them, and then they leave the institution, what goes around comes around. Those people may be very important to your institution one day in the future. And so, again, I think in some cases when the decision is made, a lot of the activity, you know, starts. I mean, I feel like I run a small, you know, placement service off the side of my desk each and every day, because I'm always looking for jobs for people. Mm-hmm. You know, for people moving from here, they're not happy. And if you take care of those people, you know, later on our institution is certainly gonna benefit. I've seen it happen.
Mm-hmm. Last few questions. Judith Rodin was a great role model for you. What did you learn from her?
I learned from Judy that leaders need to be very ambitious and very confident. And even during the worst times of Penn, and we had a lot of difficult times in the 90s in particular, I mean, undaunted, absolutely undaunted, and just so ferociously confident and ambitious, and we can do, we are Penn. When she started Penn in 1994, I think Penn was ranked 16 or 17 in the country among the, you know, the top national universities. And I remember going to meetings where people would say, well, you know, we're not Yale, we're not Harvard, we're not Princeton, and the wrath of God descended on them from her. She would not brook anything like that. We will be just as good, if not better. And when she left in 2004, number four.
Wow.
And, you know, a lot of things happened, mm-hmm. but one of it was a big act of will on her part. She just never let anyone believe or disbelieve in the notion that Penn will be among the greatest universities in the country. And it really was an extraordinary act of will, because it was so consistent for 10 years. She was just always on this, always pushing. And you'd think, well, we couldn't get this done or not done, it's too hard, and that was not an option. It was simply not an option. So she's the best leader I've ever seen, and obviously I had 7 years to work for her, and so it was very important in my formation.
What books have inspired you recently in the last few years? Is there one or two that you would say, because we have a lot of dedicated readers here, that inspired you, you'd say, it's a good read?
I would read Wallace Stegner, and in particular, oh my God, Crossing to Safety is a beautiful book. I have to read, you know, many newspapers a day, and The Economist and all these other higher ed, you know, things. And so when I'm not reading that, I just like to read literature, and I like to sort of escape into someone else's situation. I find that, in addition to just pure enjoyment, it helps me resolve some of the knots in my brain about things that I'm working on. Mm-hmm. I won't be able to, you know, think through a problem, and then I'm reading something, and then all of a sudden something has nothing to do with anything regarding Drexel will clear the way for me. Mm-hmm. And so I try to do a lot of that.
Final question. The election was so tumultuous. There's anxiety that's just palpable. What would you recommend to people as a leader, just how to move forward in our country today and in our world with all the global issues we hear about that create such a sense of fear?
There has never been a better time in America for public service. So if people aren't happy about the election, and many of us aren't, you know, tough. You know, the way to deal with that is to go out and get engaged, get involved, run for something. My daughter called me the next morning. She works up at Dartmouth College. And she was really lamenting the result. And I listened to her, and I felt bad for her. And I said, I think you should run for local school board or the public library up in where she lives in Lyme. And I said, don't let this get you down, but do something about it. I mean, get involved in your community. If you're dissatisfied, then change it. Don't accept this as the way it has to be. And, you know, go get some dirt under your fingernails and get over it. And so.
Great wisdom. Thank you for sharing your time with us.
Thank you.
Are so grateful for your leadership. God bless you, John.
Thank you. God bless you.